Thank you very much, everyone. Today, I'm going to be talking about building output, the idea of Web3 super app, which can uniquely only be built on the operating system that is Anoma. So when I think about, Okay. So crypto fundamentally, I think, is the future of finance. And I'll actually sort of give you a motivating reason for this. It is the current financial system was really built in the 70s and 80s. And this is why when you talk to banks nowadays, they will tell you things like, we've built our entire system runs in Java 6 or sometimes still in COBOL mainframes, right? And so with crypto, what we're actually getting here is the sort of the chance to rebuild a lot of very old legacy tech for the future of the internet. Because like honestly, none of this stuff was really designed for the world of like where everyone has a mobile phone, where we're on laptops constantly. And so here we really get the chance to really rebuild very cool applications that are incredibly future-proof and are just much more nicely to use than what we currently have. But the big question is, how do we actually practically get there? And maybe actually sort of before we go there, it is not just financial infrastructure that we're rebuilding here with blockchains, but rather human coordination infrastructure. I think sort of the very first use case is financial infrastructure, but sort of long-term, it's not just financial infrastructure, it's fundamentally human coordination. How do humans coordinate at scale with things like AI agents? And I'll come to this in a second. So how do we get there? Fundamentally, what do users want right now? And I think this essentially breaks down to two large categories of actually end user products. One being payments, because payments are sort of very native to our everyday life. And we've made them better at the edges, but with crypto, we can actually really make them really, really good and make them work at scale really nicely. And really, fundamentally, users just want the benefits of crypto with the ease of use of modern mobile-first applications and AI apps. Like you want seamless UX, you want multi-asset support, and you fundamentally don't really want complexity. Like you just want the ability to go on your phone and like ideally just like just type into your chatbot that you'd like to send some tokens or some money to the specific Telegram handle. The other thing, the other large category I think of applications that we're actually looking at is generally what I call decentralized brokerage. And this is everything else. This is everything that's not payments. It's essentially borrowing, lending, and trading. And like what we've seen historically is that these are the main drivers of DeFi adoption at the moment. Users want an easy way to access all tokens on any chain in a single mobile first UI. This is, and I think this is really the trick when I say, users don't care which chain they're on. They just want the experience of interacting with this modern infrastructure. Like, I think I've not yet met a user at scale that really was like, I'm only here because this is on Solana. Like users want functionality. They don't really care on what underlying infrastructure it runs. Yes. So this is fundamentally only possible, on Anoma. Because every other system was fundamentally designed around this idea of having a single global security model. Like when you think about Solana or Ethereum, like they were designed as single specific chains. And they weren't designed with the future in mind that like there will be thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of different chains, and you need an abstraction that sits on top of this, that actually application developers can build applications against that then run on all sort of past as well as future base layer infrastructure. And this is really what Anoma allows you to do. Because Anoma is the first infrastructure that just natively spans multiple chains. Like you can have an Anoma application run on Ethereum, you can have it run on Solana, you can have parts of your state live on Celestia. This is what the distributed operating system of Anoma actually gives you. It gives you this ability to say, I'm building against this operating system, and I don't actually fundamentally care on which specific CPU or which specific base layer it runs right now. So the future of finance, I think, looks something like this, where users honestly most likely just use chat applications to type in, like, I currently have some ETH, and I'd just like to get borrow some USDC against this. And then a local AI agent will sort of pass this into very specific intent, and then the user goes, okay, yeah, this actually describes exactly what I want, let me send this off. And then the user will just receive a reply from a number of solvers on like, these are the possible ways to do it. The users aren't going to figure out themselves, here are these 15 different DeFi pools, which one has the best rate for me at the moment. Like, I can't explain this to any normal person, really. Like when I go, oh, this is how crypto works. You should be looking at all these different apps on all these different chains, and you should be rebalancing every 30 seconds. No user will want to do this. With Anoma, users can describe fundamentally the outcome that they want. They don't have to worry about the specific execution traits. They just describe a specific outcome rather than a sort of like computational trace of how to get there. And then this is outsourced to the compute, and like figuring out the best solution is actually outsourced to the solvers. The other really important thing, I think, is that most users don't really want to reveal to their neighbors whether they've just been to the doctors or not. And I think sort of another important aspect is like keeping sensitive information local to user devices. I just very practically do not see a chance that we get any sort of traction in the mainstream audiences without this as a feature set, because I don't know, but like if I talk to someone in the real world and I go like, yes, all your neighbors will know what kind of prescription drugs you buy at the pharmacy, they all go, why would I possibly want this as a behavior of the system? And the nice thing is with Anoma, you don't have this. So what can you specifically do? Well, with the super app, you get seamless multi-chain DeFi. You get trading, swaps, lending, borrowed, leverages. I would describe this as you get decentralized prime brokerage, something that was historically only available to the super wealthy, like where you can call up your banker and go, I would like this specific product, please provide it to me, and then he'd call you back maybe 2 or 3 hours later, and then ideally you get the product. I think for the future of crypto, just I'm going to be chatting here on my phone with my local AI agent who generates me these intents, and then I essentially get my own prime brokerage, but in a fully decentralized way. You also get user-friendly payments. You get integrated chat and social media. And like I think the long-term dream here is really that you get the super nice experience without all the middlemen taking a cut. Like you get an Uber-like experience in the same application as you get your payments integrations, but without having to rely on Uber taking a sort of a 20 or 30% cut. How am I doing on time? Okay, fine. So crypto is heading in this direction anyway, and I think this future is very inevitable. But Anoma is at the moment the only place where you can actually build this kind of future. And I think one often overlooked but very important aspect of this, ooh, I get a timer, fantastic, thank you. One often overlooked problem is that different users have different requirements in terms of their trust assumptions. Not everyone wants to trust global Ethereum. And I don't know, but you should try this in the audience, like talk to your friends, talk to your parents, talk to your family, and ask them whether they will trust global Ethereum. And I've done this, and like my parents don't trust this, because why would they? They live in Germany, they actually like their local security model. They don't want to outsource their financial trust to some global decentralized system that they don't understand. So not everyone will want the same security model. And Anoma is the only place where you can actually get, where you can build single applications that work in many different security models. At the moment, you always have to make the choice. Like you either build against the Ethereum model, or you build against the Solana model, or you build against a rollup model. In Anoma, you can just make the choice. I'm building an application here, and the users decide where they want to run this application. Like if a user wants to run your specific application on, I don't know, the City of Seoul's blockchain for local payments, the user can make this choice to run that application in that security model. If the user wants to make the choice to run this on global Ethereum because this is their preferred trust model, they can also do that. This is, and I think this is really important because crypto is all about like building sovereign systems that are very resilient. And we end up in this world where we just like build single security models, but never really considered how we would sort of how people would transition and like move around these single security models into like when they actually want to move between them. There we go. So, just to recap, users fundamentally just express their intent, and then they essentially throw it into a magic box called the Anoma Intent Machine. And the Anoma Intent Machine is a distributed operating system. It's the ability to run the same operating system like Windows, but on many different machines that are networked over the internet, and that are latency domain independent. And then the system figures out what are possible options. And then this gets presented back to the user, and then the user can decide, do I want to take this specific option or that specific option? It's important to note that just because the user wants something doesn't mean that this is necessarily possible, right? Like, I think everyone here would like to buy Bitcoin for a dollar. You can express this as an intent. This does not mean that your intent will get settled, because some things are not actually possible. But if the user sort of expresses, I'd call them realistic constraints, the system comes back and goes, yes, these are options that adhere to your realistic constraints, And then if the user likes them, then the user can get them executed. And here the important thing is the user can get them executed on every system. So like the user may say, I would like to buy some ETH for Bitcoin. Give me the best price on, Solana, Ethereum, and maybe even some future Bitcoin ZKVM system. And then sort of the system comes back and goes, here's the best price, and maybe this is on Solana, and then the user just hits OK, and then this is also executed on Solana. So what are the sort of quick building blocks here to actually make this possible? Well, one is intents, and intents are very different than transactions. Transactions are the thing that I think you're all used to, but they don't actually really capture what you want as a user. Like a transaction is a fully fledged state transition, and intent, on the other hand, is a partial state transition. So it's the ability to say, I have some ETH and I want some Bitcoin. You cannot execute this directly on chain. You first need some actual counterparty discovery to be done and finding some other counterparty with whom to coordinate. The next thing is you get data sovereignty, which honestly just brings crypto up to speed with like what traditional systems already offer us. Like it'd be insane if you published all the information about your pharmacy purchases to everyone in the world. And like this is also, it's a question about security here in the end. Like data sovereignty is a question about security. And this is, I think, also why we have not yet really seen massive Web2 adoption of our technology. It's because we all try to convince them for the longest time that, totally, Samsung, go trust global Ethereum. The validator set definitely will not screw with you. But like Samsung, like why would Samsung want to trust global Ethereum? This is not currently in their trust model. Why would they want to put this in their trust model? And I think this is a really fundamental challenge to enabling actual realistic real world adoption, is to give Web2 companies the ability to run sovereign infrastructure that can interoperate with what we're building in Web3. We're not onboarding people from Web2 into Web3. We've got to make it compatible, where we're not going to change the fundamental trust assumptions. And this is what Anoma is designed around. And then the last thing is chain abstraction. No one cares. Like, build apps, like, you should be building apps that people love and not building chains. Like, no one cares on, like, we have 15,000 different chains. End users care about what specific functionality they get. They do not care where it runs. So Anoma is the first distributed operating system. And in my mind, this is really, it's the Windows 95 moment, where prior to actually having good operating systems, we were always stuck in this world where like you had to build against specific CPUs, against specific chipsets. And now a new chipset came around and like all of a sudden your applications didn't work anymore. And with Windows, for the first time, we like, actually started living in this world where like it didn't, like you didn't build your application against a specific operating system, against a specific CPU, you built against the operating system. And then future CPUs came along, and then Windows also ran on these future CPUs, and along with it, all the existing applications ran there. And to me, this is by far the most exciting thing, because I think so far we've really been building sort of like cool technical innovations, but I think this will actually enable large scale adoption as in a way that we haven't seen before. So what is a crypto-native operating system, or what is a Web3 distributed operating system? It's a higher level of abstraction on top of existing blockchains and infrastructure. It gives you a single interface that you can use to build applications against. So that instead of having to build against sort of every specific chain itself, you build against a single abstraction of an operating system, and then it runs on also future chains that you may not even know about at the moment. And the nice thing is, like when you think about Windows, Windows is not aware that there are like thousands of computers in the city, or hundreds of thousands of computers in the city. Whereas a distributed operating system with Anoma is actually aware of all these different kind of machines. So you can start leveraging this from an application developer's perspective. You can say things like, oh, I'd like to store my data on Celestia. I'd like to maybe store my IP rights on Story. I would like to store most of my financial assets on Ethereum. But like the operating system of Anoma is fundamentally aware that there's more than one computer in the world and how these things are connected to each other, and they have the ability to move assets between them. Yes, I hope you can see this. This is essentially sort of the diagram of Anoma, the operating system. You have an underlying infrastructure layer, and we will keep adding to this infrastructure layer. Then you have a networking layer, which is how all the solvers start moving data around, all the nodes that start connecting these different computers and make sure that data actually gets shuttled around. And on top of this, you have an application layer, which is where users interact with applications that developers build. One OS, many super apps. This is, I think, the other important thing. This is not about having one app to rule them all. You want to have localized things. And it's weird that crypto sort of missed that point for a long time. But you want to have localized things because 8 billion people in the world, many people have different requirements. Not everyone wants the same trust model. Not everyone wants the same user interface. So with Anoma, you can actually have global super apps. You can have regional super apps. You can have super specific community apps, right? Like I live in a very small town right now with 25,000 people. Like, honestly, with Anoma, you can just build like local payment infrastructure for those 25,000 people. But the nice thing is I can roam with my assets when I travel to Seoul. Like, maybe most of the time my assets are secured by my local community because this is my preferred trust model. But when I come here, I actually can start roaming with parts of my assets over time. Yeah, and this is the other huge point. Like, I'm still surprised that no one else is starting to think about this, but there's a reason why national governments don't really want to issue their national currencies on global Ethereum. Because why in the world would you give up your national monetary sovereignty to global Ethereum? This makes zero sense. No one in their right mind is going to do this. So you want to have support very specific regional compliance setups where you can say, well, we're running the South Korea chain that issues the KRW. And like, sure, under some specific rules, you can move assets out into the rest of the ecosystem, but it's not that like there's a KRW that's just native on Ethereum and the validator set can print arbitrary amounts of this. So Anoma's coming to mainnet. It's very exciting. So if you're a developer in the audience, come check it out. You can go to github.com/Anoma/Anoma. There's a lot of cool things. And I will leave you with this, which is, I think for the last 6 or 7 years, we've like really since Ethereum, we've done very little innovative things. I mean, like we've innovated around the edges. And like sure, proof times have gotten faster and we've like now some cool ZKVMs. But like fundamentally, like if you used Ethereum 6 years ago, it's exactly the same thing today. There's nothing fundamentally that we got in terms of new primitives that allow us to build us structurally different applications. So if you're a developer and you'd like to try something new, something fun, something interesting, where you can do things that you couldn't have done before, do check out Anoma. It's just a fun place to build applications that are much more usable for practical end user purposes than what you can build nowadays. So yeah, thank you very much. That's it.